because COVID shows how important it is, right? So yeah, which is why we need to take this moment to organize like never before.
Which is, you know, like Joe Biden, I mean, he's exceeded all my expectations.
Yeah.
Joe Biden's been great. He's the most pro-union president we'll ever see.
Well, it's a great opportunity. We still have to pass the PRO Act.
I know the PRO Act.
We still have to pass the infrastructure.
And without voting rights, too, none of it's going to matter. And
right, but right, exactly. But passing the
what is the PRO Act exactly?
The PRO Act is labor law reform, because labor law in our country is completely broken, which is why you've got only 7% of the private sector workforce organized when a majority of people want a union. And the whole country got an education in how broken our labor laws are when the Amazon thing happened.
Right.
Because the way our labor laws are set up, you've got supposedly a free and fair election, right, whether to go union. But one candidate in the election, which is the employer.
Well, you're spotting basically labor law, to, as I understand it, to dumb it down to my level, is basically, you know, employers have a 2-touchdown advantage at the start of the game.
Right.
You know?
Well, yeah, because they have unlimited access to the voters.
Right.
And they can sit you down one-on-one or in groups and yell at you and scream at you and threaten you and lie to you and break you down. And then the union doesn't get equal time.
I have this Clockwork Orange vision of
It is a lot like Clockwork Orange. Actually,
mandatory employer
meeting. Yeah, the scene where they make him watch the movie and they hold his eyelids open.
They pin his eyelids
That's
open.
That's pretty much what the employer can do. They can force you to listen to and watch their message, their union busting message, for hours and hours and hours.
And they do. Yeah.
Yeah. And these are the people that control your livelihood. And that, so, you know, so it's in, the whole thing is totally coercive, totally unfair. And then the union doesn't get equal time. So what kind of election is that?
Right.
That's not a real election. I mean, could you imagine like if there was an election for Congress and one candidate could sit all the voters down for a month and talk to them and threaten them and do all this stuff, and the other candidate
mandatory.
Could never talk to them?
Mandatory.
Yeah, too. Mandatory. So that's not a democratic election. So the PRO Act would create a lot of protections like equal time for unions. If the employer does a captive meeting, then the union gets equal time. If the employer threatens workers, then there are actual real penalties. Because the way it works now is, if you violate labor law, then you know you get a slap on the wrist. You get a post.
You post a notice. Yeah,
you have to put up a notice that said we violated labor law. Or if you fire a union activist for being a union,
which is going to happen.
Which happens in many elections.
Step one of a union election is you fire one guy, and they may end up getting him back to work and paying him every penny plus.
Right, but the employers are very happy to spend that money.
But that happens after the fact, after the election's over, yeah.
So the employers do a very simple calculation, okay? It's going to cost this much for us to have a union, because the economists have studied the question and they've realized that paying workers more costs more paying workers less.
No, wait a minute. We're told in a supply side economic society that if we give the money to the people that have it, we get more money.
No, if you give so here's the thing, is that when everybody's union, I mean, if you look at this, if you look at the numbers, when we had the strongest unions in the 50s and 60s, working people had a larger share of income. We had more equality across the board. We had a middle class that was sound. Now, even at the height of that, the rich people were still rich. Okay.
Right.
So it's not a question of they're going to be broke. It's a question of, for working people to be paid fairly, rich people just have to be a little bit less rich.
Well,
what the hell is wrong with that?
I know.
What is wrong? Do these guys really need to have this many billions?
Bezos is going up in a fucking rocket in a few days.
Let him stay in space.
Bezos and his rocket. Yeah. No, his wife, who got half, I think she's straight, got half or close to it.
Hell, I'd take a quarter.
Billions. She gave it all away and married a school teacher in Seattle.
Yeah.
Remarried.
Well, you know, the thing is that there's no...
By the way, Bezos isn't a Musk. Musk is a dick. But Bezos and these guys, I mean, they're so
well,
rich.
There's no reason. So here's the thing. Why should we have an economy where a handful of people have more wealth than they will ever need in a million years, and regular working people don't have enough to live? it doesn't have to be that way.
Right.
And that's the fundamental crisis in
families
our
families get wiped out with one bad illness in a family, and they get wiped out.
Yeah. And so, but it doesn't have to be that way in the richest country in the world.
The
thing about it is that we've been talking about this crisis of wealth and pay inequality for so long. The unions are the only ones that have the answer to it, because unions are the kind of market based solution to the problem. You just give workers a seat at the table, you give them power, just like the employers have power, and you can have a real, actual, fair bargaining over what is the fair pay for our work. And
closer.
And that changes everything.
Right.
Because then workers get paid what they're worth.
My dad, who was a labor guy, used to say if unions didn't exist in a capitalist society, they'd have to invent it. To keep the balance, you know.
Well, they did.
They did. Of course. Yes.
No, but it's true, because before there were unions, we had people working 12, 14, 16-hour days with no protections, no pay. You had kids working in the mines and the fields. It meant if you were an industrial worker or a truck driver or a mine worker or an office worker, it meant a life of poverty. When unions came in, even the playing fields just a little bit, we had a middle class in this country where a working class job meant you could support your family, send your kids to college, have food on the table, and a retirement with dignity after your lifetime.
Amen to that.
Right. So that's what unions have given to this country. So now, with unions being weaker, we see that we're going back to the bad old days.
Well, the irony is, too, is then you end up with these huge social problems, and government's got to come in and solve these problems at a different level. In other words, like, if you don't provide healthcare, if people aren't provided healthcare at their Walmart jobs, right, then somebody's got to step in and provide insurance for these people. So now you've ended up having to create a government program to cover the insurance that Walmart's not paying its employees.
Yeah,
you know?
Well, it's corporate welfare is what it is, because all these, you know, Walmart and Amazon, all these employees, the government is paying their healthcare, but also paying, you know, food stamps and other kinds of programs, because these employers are not paying a living wage.
Right.
So, and that's bad for,
and it's a government subsidy.
Well, then the taxpayer's paying for that.
Right.
And that's why.
And the Waltons, the money that the taxpayers have to pay, the Walton family in the case of Walmart, they're it's almost like giving them the tax money.
Well, that's right. It's a reverse Robin Hood situation. That's what we have, is reverse Robin Hood right now. We have, you know, Robin Hood took from the rich and gave to the poor.
Yeah.
What we do right now is we take from the poor and we give to the rich. It's crazy. Right. So I had a really brilliant point that I was just going to make.
I fucked it up, didn't I?
You did. But I'll forgive you, because I don't
know. No, so we were reverse Robin Hood.
Well, right. But the other problem, the other problem that we have is when you have this great inequality in wealth, you have more recessions. The economy suffers because when working people get paid fairly, they put the money back into the system by buying stuff. Okay. And so you have fewer recessions, you have a better economy for everybody. So really,
well, like I've always said, if you give rich people money, they know what to do with it. They save it.
Right.
You know, you give my neighbor money and he goes and buys a new truck, you know.
Right. Exactly.
The money gets straight back into the economy.
The workers are buying stuff they need.
Yeah.
And that's good for the economy.
Yeah.
That's how it
creates
be.
Economic. But the point is giving, you know, the supply side argument, this wealthy argument, you give rich people money, it does not create the economic activity that it does to give the middle class money.
That's right.
Exactly. It's just bottom line economic activity.
Yeah. And so that's what, you know, that's part of why we've had some of the economic problems that we've had. And, you know, and things just keep getting worse. During the COVID epidemic, you have guys like Bezos and Musk and Amazon and so on. They are getting richer and richer and richer. But working people have really suffered through this pandemic, especially non-union workers who've been lost their jobs by the millions. And, you know, there were huge bailouts for the corporations. Workers got, you know, $600 check or whatever.
Right, right.
But so things just keep getting worse and worse without unions being strong. So I think you asked about an hour ago about the PRO Act.
Yeah, the PRO Act. PRO Act.
The whole point of the PRO Act is to give workers the right to form a union and the right to bargain a contract. And if you do that basic thing, It will change everything in our country because working people will, you will see working people's standards rise. You'll see this disgusting gap in wealth between the rich and the poor close up, and you'll see a much more fair and just country than what we have now. And by the way, I think that you'll also see us stabilizing in our politics, because so much of our politics is driven, you know, people's grievances being pointed in the wrong direction.
Economic insecurity, right?
Yeah. So you've got people that are working people are suffering in every demographic.
Falling behind, right? They're sinking.
But you've got misleaders who go to the white workers and say, okay, the reason that you're suffering is because of those immigrants, or it's because of those black people that want something. Okay.
Just pitting one person against another.
Yes. Yeah. Instead of it's those billionaires that are taking everything from everybody. And if we all unite, because our union movement is black, brown, and white, and unity, solidarity means unity of everybody.
Right.
And so if we all were to unite, then we would have a lot more power. Right. But,
and that's the boogeyman of, and I think everybody falls a little bit on the right and the left, you know, politically on certain issues. But, you know, the boogeyman is that everybody wants to tear everything down and turn it into a communist state. You know what I mean? That's what they're selling in the Midwest. And it's nonsense.
It is nonsense. Well, unions are market-based.
We want healthy, vibrant companies that take care of their employees.
Right. And the Teamsters have always said, we want our employers to be successful, because then if the employers are successful, then
you can't have a job if there's no employer.
Have jobs, yeah. And then they'll have money to pay fair wages. So we're not a union that says tear it all down. Unions are a market-based solution to wealth inequality. In the context of capitalist system, you've got employers who are these corporations, they're built to make money. And the way they want to make money is exploit workers. They want to pay you the lowest that they can pay you.
Corporations are like these mindless, soulless robots whose missions are to make money, not to protect the environment or anything else.
Right, exactly. Yeah. So that's why we need laws that say,
exactly,
while you're making money, don't burn down the environment. Okay.
Right.
While you're making
money, don't poison
the
water.
While you're making money, don't kill the workers with unsafe, right? So that's why we need laws, but also that's why we need unions. Because the union's job, the employer's job, is to make as much money as they can, and also to make a product or service that someone wants to buy and that's useful. Our job in the union is to make sure that while we're making all that happen, because it's our work that makes all that happen, that we're treated fairly, paid fairly. And that's our job. That's our role. Because the employer's never going to do it.
Right.
The employer's always.
And that's the union's. So you're getting down to the fundamental, which I think a lot of people forget. And that's the union's role in a capitalist society. There's there's no unions in a communist society. You know?
Well, right. And so our role
Keep capitalists honest.
Yeah, because without unions in a capitalist society, you're going to have terrible problems.
They'll just wholesale take advantage of people.
They'll exploit. And that's what we saw in our history before there were unions, when workers had no rights and it was brutal to have to work a job in industry or in the mines or the fields or what have you. So unions are fundamental to our system and to our democracy, in my opinion. And unions also fight for equality. They create equality for all people, because our job is to unite the working class and to win a fair share of the wealth we create. And the working class that we represent is black, brown, and white. It's men and women. It's gay and straight. It's all different demographics. So the only way we win is to unite everybody.
And we want to see everybody get more, whether you're black, brown, gay, straight.
Exactly. And the only way we can do that is to fight against discrimination. That's why I'm so proud that our union stepped up and said we oppose racism, you know. And from the founding in 1903 in our Constitution, through the Civil Rights Movement, and now with the Black Lives Matter movement, our union has said we're against racism. We're for justice for all people. And that's fundamental to our mission. And I'm proud of how our union has stepped up. And of course, we're not perfect.
Man, it hurts that we're in 2021 and we're still arguing about, racism's, I would certainly at an all-time high in my lifetime.
Yeah. Well, and that's, we have some very powerful folks that have really tried to stoke that. And the stuff on social media, it's just ugly.
I mean, without getting too deep in politics, MAGA, the whole MAGA movement, you know, America First is born in racism. It's just a racist movement. And even the people